Sir, can we start? Yeah. So, good evening, friends. Welcome to today's program. Like as you all are aware, we are having classes on acute care medicine from covering different topics in acute care medicine. Initially, this was started as a program with the help of Government of Kerala and again the State Institute on Health and Family Welfare. So now we are having audience from different specialties and again different parts of the country. So today we have a very good topic. Today we have a talk on rickettsial fevers. As you all are well aware, in India we have different diseases, febrile illnesses. So and again during the rainy season, the number of such fevers is also going to come up. Especially dengue fever, rickettsial fever, leptospirosis, etc. So this topic is very relevant in today's situation. And today we are having an excellent speaker with us, Dr. J.V. Peter. He's a former chief of critical care medicine in CMC Vellore. And now he's the director of CMC Vellore and one of the senior most and best intensivists in India and a best speaker. As a juniors in critical care medicine, we always try to do the things like the way Dr. Peters used to do. He's a good academician. He's having many publications in different fields of critical care medicine. So over to you, sir, Peters.
Thank you so much, Anup, for your kind words of introduction. I was so relieved when you asked me to talk on something other than COVID. I think all of us are saturated with information on COVID to an extent that I think we have neglected other common problems that we are faced with. And so it's a welcome change to be able to speak on a subject that is very close to my heart, a subject on which we have done a fair amount of work at CMC Vellore, and some of those I will be presenting today. Is the screen shared, Anup?
Yes, sir, clear. Perfectly all right.
This was the talk that was given to me a couple of years back in one of the critical care conferences. And what I've done is updated this talk because I think it is very important for us to ask this question as to whether we are missing the diagnosis. And Dr. Anup, at the end of it, will present to you a couple of case scenarios which we'll discuss through. For the outline for the talk, I'll start with a brief introduction. I'll talk about a typical patient. What is the probability of scrub typhus from several perspectives? What are the clinical aspects and management, and then some concluding remarks. This was an interesting quote that I read about scrub typhus, and maybe in those pre-diagnostic era times, they had to rely a lot on clinical medicine. And the quote says, "The only English patients I have ever known refuse tea have been scrub typhus cases, and the first sign of them getting better was their craving again for tea." None other than Florence Nightingale made the statement. Would refusal to have tea suggest scrub typhus? Such a question may be very irrelevant now. So whenever we have a disease or a problem, how do we go through this decision process? We look at a diagnostic likelihood of whether it is a particular disease or not. And we look at a pre-testing probability, and the probability which changes after testing. Now, if after the test you find that the probability of the disease is low, you may not treat it, or you may not even test if the test is not going to be picking up the disease. But if the probability after the test is very high, then you would initiate treatment. So who are the patients whom you would test in the clinical setting of a suspected scrub? And at what threshold of the diagnostic test would you say, hey, this is scrub typhus, I need to treat it? And we rely a lot on pre-test probability as well as post-test probability. And that's where we apply the test and we say, okay, the pre-test probability was so much. After the test, the post-test probability of the diagnosis is so much. Let us start with an illustrative case of a 30-year-old farmer. Not an uncommon setting. Presents with fever, body ache, and headache of a fairly long duration, 7 days.
Sorry, there is
the
some
symptoms.
So you will have to repeat, sir. There was some connectivity issue.
Sorry. So let's take the issue of a 30-year-old farmer who presents with fever, body ache, and headache. In the initial phase of the illness, those may be the only symptoms that the patient presents with, and it presents to you as a diagnostic dilemma. But if the patient presents a little later, you may have added symptoms that may help you to hone in as to what the disease is. So this illustrative case, the patient develops breathlessness also, which is of 3 days duration, drowsiness, which is a 1 day duration, but does not have any seizures. On presentation to the emergency department, this patient is tachycardic, mildly hypotensive, tachypneic, hypoxic, and has a low Glasgow coma score. You are that astute physician, clinician, who does a very detailed examination. You find a small dry scab in the left axilla. You hear inspiratory crackles in the lungs. The liver is palpable 2 centimeters below the costal margin, and the spleen is not palpable. You send off some routine investigations. You find that the hemoglobin is slightly low, mild thrombocytopenia, and a mild neutrophilia. Creatinine is borderline, it's not borderline, it's high, 2.2, and there is mild transaminitis. The chest x-ray shows bilateral fluffy opacities, and the blood gas shows acidosis with hypoxia, and you find that it's predominantly a metabolic acidosis with a basis of -6 and a slight increase in the lactate levels. So whenever you are confronted with a problem like this, whether it's in the casualty or in the intensive care, the first question that you need to ask is it a differentiated fever? Now, what do we mean by a differentiated fever? It is a patient who presents with obvious symptoms pointing out to a particular organ system. For example, if the patient presents with frequency, dysuria, loin pain, obviously it points out to the urogenital tract. If the patient has cough with purulent sputum production, breathlessness, it points you out to the respiratory system and likewise. But some patients present without an obvious focus of infection, and that you call it as undifferentiated fever. And then you need to go through an algorithm as to what would be the possible cause of fever. Now, if you look at the case that was illustrative case that was presented to us, a farmer with sort of very non-specific symptoms and developing, you know, breathlessness and altered sensorium late in the disease, it fits in with more with an undifferentiated fever rather than a differentiated fever. Now, when you have a patient with an undifferentiated fever, which is very, very common in our country because there are so many fevers that present with in an undifferentiated form, we need to go through an algorithm as to what it could be. And this depends on which geographical area that the patient comes from and where your hospital is situated, the clinical pattern of presentation, and what sort of syndrome they present with. Is it a predominantly fever arthralgia symptom, or a fever myalgia syndrome, or a fever icterus syndrome? That is one potential way by which you can approach. But people also approach it in a slightly different manner in terms of which is the predominant organ that is involved. for example, fever with thrombocytopenia, a list of differentials will be slightly different to fever with hepatorenal syndrome or fever with altered sensorium. Now, let us look at the probability of scrub typhus for this particular illustrative case at three levels. The first is an epidemiological perspective. The second is a clinical perspective. And third is a laboratory investigative perspective. And we look at this one by one. Let's go through the epidemiological perspective. Now, scrub typhus is much, much more common than we think it is. This is data of seroprevalence, which sort of gives you an information on what's the background activity in the region where you come from. If you look at Australia, it's about 2.6%. India, it ranges from 15% to even 60%. So again, that goes back to what I said earlier, which is the geographical area from which the patient comes. And what are the common causes of undifferentiated fever in those areas? And so on and so forth. In Indonesia, it's 9.4%, and Japan. So these are prevalence from different countries. But what is obvious from the slide is that there is a background high prevalence of disease in India. We have not really been looking for it, and probably that's why we have been missing. Now, if you look at the Tsushigamishi triangle, as they call it, the countries where scrub typhus is quite common, and that is highlighted in the gray area, there are the Southeast Asian countries and the northern part of Australia where this disease is commonly prevalent. Now, there are now several studies that have looked at different serotypes that are available, and we also have a published data from CMC. The common type in Vietnam is called CARP, but there are several other subtypes that are seen worldwide, and this is just an illustrative slide of what are the different serotypes. Now, you may ask me, you know, what's the importance of all this? These are more for research purposes, and the different serotypes may help us understand severity of disease, presentation, response to therapy in future. In India, the common serotypes are keto-like in about two-thirds and CARP-like serotype in about one-third. This is just to complete the whole picture. It may not be directly linked to the case that we are trying to look at. Now, I initially said that it all depends on the geographical area where you are. Now, if you look at this study where we looked at 398 patients who presented with undifferentiated fever, so this also gives you a spectrum of the common problems that we see that present like an undifferentiated fever, nearly 50% of our patients coming to our institution were diagnosed of scrub typhus. Now, the other causes of undifferentiated fever are malaria, dengue, enteric fever, leptospirosis, antivirus, and a very small proportion spotted fever. So if you come from a malaria endemic belt, your case mix may be that malaria may be predominant or enteric may be predominant, Kerala may be leptospirosis. But so you need to be aware in your geographical region, what are the common diseases that cause this undifferentiated fever? Then it becomes a little easy to go through this approach, algorithmic approach, epidemiological perspective, clinical perspective, laboratory perspective, tie everything in it, and then come to a diagnosis. Now, we can also look at it from the time of the year. Now, we hardly see scrub typhus during summer. But once the rain starts and the winter months set in, it's after the rains, it's when we see in our region in CMC. So we see the peak during October, November, December, and January. Now, is it the same in other countries? No, it isn't. Data from Vietnam shows that the peak occurs between April, May, June, and starts dropping from July to August. If you look at data from China, it's almost similar. It starts a little earlier than India and peaks a little earlier also in China. So you also need to know from your region, when do these patients come? And that again alters your ranking. I call it rank order when you're saying it's an undifferentiated infected fever, the first rank order is this, second rank order is this, third rank order is this. As I said earlier, it depends on the geographical location, the time of the year. Let's move on. Now, in India, do we see only scrub typhus or are there other rickettsial illness? Now, the answer to this is not very clear, but if you look at the entire spectrum of rickettsial illness, we have tick-borne rickettsial illness, flea-borne rickettsial illness, which belong to the spotted fever group, as well as mite-borne. I've just given the list of organisms that can cause. In the typhus group, there are two, flea-borne and louse-borne, and each of these are different rickettsial species. On the other end of the spectrum is the scrub typhus group, which is mite-borne, which is the Orientalis tsugamushi, which is what is our organism of interest. Now, this is putting the whole thing in a different form. The organism, what disease it produces, whether it's Rocky Mountain spotted fever or epidemic typhus or murine typhus or scrub typhus, what is the vector and what is the reservoir. Occasionally, we have see other rickettsial species. And the way we go about it is that, you know, the clinical feature seems to suggest scrub, but the serology is negative. There's no definite eschar. There is a rash. Then we might do other diagnostic tests. But there is, at the moment, all we have is a wheel Felix test, which is a little non-specific. Let's move on from an epidemiological perspective to the clinical perspective. Now, what is the probability that this patient was presented with this clinical syndrome as scrub typhus? He comes from a semi-urban area or rural. He's a farmer and he's likely to be exposed to shrubs. Now, does it mean that people coming from cities will never develop scrub typhus? That's a wrong notion, because we have seen patients who come from purely urban areas who still turn out to be scrub typhus. Now, the general systemic manifestations of fever, myalgia, rash, vomiting, headache are common to many disease processes, and they may not really give you insight as to whether it is scrub typhus. But the syndromic organ dysfunction is quite unique to scrub typhus. Now, you may argue that malaria can also cause thrombocytopenia. Leptospirosis can also cause thrombocytopenia. Shock can be seen in different tropical fevers. But this combination of hematological cardiovascular ARDS with very mild transaminitis and mild liver, mild renal failure generally fits in with scrub types. Of course, it can be leptospirosis, it can be malaria, enteric can also present with all these manifestations. Hantavirus can present as a pulmonary renal syndrome. Yes, all these will come under your differentials, but based on the type of organ involvement, you can rank them in the order of priorities. Now, when we looked at a critically ill cohort who presented with scrub typhus to our institution, we find that a large number of patients had respiratory involvement. So ARDS was quite predominant, and there was a very interesting question that was posed at the beginning of the session: how do you differentiate ARDS from scrub typhus and COVID? In the winter, the rains start coming. Patients present with a syndromic approach, how do you differentiate? We'll look at that at the end. But thrombocytopenia is quite common. Hepatic dysfunction, again, in about more than 2/3 of patients. Mild renal failure, shock can be seen. Altered sensorium is seen only in about 25% of patients, and that is due to aseptic meningitis. Now, so you add on to the clinical syndromic presentation a typical eschar, it is highly, highly suggestive of scrub typhus. Now, there are other disease processes that may give you a picture like this. I'm reminded of the malignant pustule, which one patient presented to during our PG days. And we occasionally have other disease processes that present like this. But in a clinical setting like this, the presence of an eschar is highly, highly, highly suggestive of scrub typhus. It is seen only in about 50% of patients, but if it's found, it is almost diagnostic. Now, our practice has changed over years in that if the patient has a typical eschar, we only give them doxycycline, no other antibiotics. Earlier, we were not so confident, but now, if the patient comes with that typical syndrome with an eschar, it is only doxycycline. Now, where all can they have the eschar? This is a publication again from our institution which has looked at the distribution of eschar in males and females. You really need to search very hard to find it. Sometimes it may be hidden under the armpits, or it may be in the groin or thighs or neck or axilla. But in females, it's predominantly in the chest and abdomen, and in the males, it's in the axilla, groin, and genitalia. Now, in this particular study, the presence of an eschar suggested higher mortality. Now, we all know that this organism is an obligate intracellular coccobacilli. It's a gram-negative bacilli, which is better stained with GIMSA. They have RNA and DNA, and are sensitive. They are sensitive to antibiotics. So we have gone from epidemiological to clinical criteria, but we also need to do some laboratory tests to see whether this is definitely scrub typhus. Now, when we do diagnostic tests, we are looking at tests which have a good sensitivity and specificity. And often there could be a trade-off between the two. Now, you may all know about snout and spin. That is a highly sensitive test you rule out if negative. And look at specificity spin. That is a specific test you rule in. With that background, let's go on to another concept which is important. What is the probability of a test telling us whether it's scrub typhus or not based on the prevalence of disease? It's another important concept that we need to keep in mind, that the positive and negative prevalence of a test, sorry, predictive value of a test is influenced by the prevalence of disease. So in a country like India, where there's a high prevalence of the disease, you are more likely to increase the positive and negative predictive value based on the test. What I'm trying to say is, in a high prevalence setting, it is more likely that persons who test positive truly have the disease than if the test is performed in a population with low prevalence. So that is something that we need to keep in mind for any disease that we are approaching. That's what I'm trying to imply in this statement, that in a country or in a setting where there is high prevalence, the tests will have a high positive predictive value. Now, the next thing that we need to understand in terms of diagnostic tests is something called the likelihood ratio, or the diagnostic or the predictive ability of the test. And the formulae are given there. It takes into consideration sensitivity and specificity. So it looks at true positive, false positive, true negative, and false negative. And then you have a likelihood ratio. So you can have a likelihood ratio of a positive test and a likelihood ratio of a negative test. So let's look at, on the right hand side, some examples. Now, in the scenario that we looked at, this is a fairly high probability that this patient has got scrub typhus. This is the pre-test probability. So my pre-test probability based on the scenario may be 80 or 90%. And then I'm doing a test which has a low likelihood ratio, say 0.5. Still, my post-test probability of it being scrub typhus is going to be high. On the other hand, if I have a 80% pre-test probability and the likelihood test ratio of the test is 1, my post-test probability is also the same. If, on the other hand, the likelihood ratio of a positive test is higher, I increase the pre-test probability by the post-test probability. On the other hand, if I have a very low pre-test probability of the test, of the disease, based on the clinical or prevalence, even a very high diagnostic accuracy of the test would only increase my post-test probability to some extent. Now, I will leave that for the moment and briefly look at what are the types of diagnostic tests we have for Scrub typhus. The gold standard obviously is to identify the organism through cell cultures. It's very cumbersome. It takes several weeks and it's not easy to culture these organisms, and you need a biosafety lab of 2B or at least or 3. We can detect the antigen. You can detect the antigen from the ESHCAR. You take the sample from the ESHCAR, a biopsy, or you can take the buffy coat and try and detect the antigen. But these tests have low sensitivity and specificity. Alternatively, we can detect the antibody. The reference test is an IFA IgM antibodies, but what is commonly used is an ELISA IgM, which has a sensitivity and specificity similar to that of IFA and a diagnostic accuracy of over 90%. And this is what is used in most centers. And what I have presented in the slide is actually data from India. Now, there are several point of care tests that are available from different labs. In CMC, we use the PanBio, but there are other tests. We also have we are a reference lab, so they have other tests that they use. And if you look at all these tests, they have a reasonable sensitivity and specificity. Sensitivity is a little low in the pooled analysis of different tests, but the pooled specificity is quite high. So again, this suggests that the tests are better at ruling in the disease than ruling it out. So if you have a high pre-test probability, the setting is right, and the test comes positive, it's highly likely that you're dealing with Scrub typhus. That's the interpretation. So let's put all of this together. So we have an environment in India where there is a high prevalence of disease. If the patient presents with a typical clinical syndrome, particularly with an ESHCAR and with a reasonably good diagnostic test, we should be able to pick up Scrub typhus. So my point that I'm trying to say is we cannot afford to miss the diagnosis of Scrub typhus. So you may ask me, why not? Now, if you look at data, this is mainly data from CMC, we have a very large series of 623 patients over a few years. And when we followed them up, we found that the mortality was not too bad. It's 9%. But what we also observed that over time, this mortality has actually dropped. And that's because all our clinicians are extremely trained to suspect and to diagnose Scrub typhus. So if you suspect, you will pick it up. If you pick it up early, you will treat it appropriately and your outcomes will be better. I still remember when I came back from Australia, a person with multi-organ failure, I didn't even think of Scrub typhus. And this patient was on very high-end antibiotics. And this is what happens often in our clinical setting. Patient comes with multi-organ failure, we are so worried, it'll be meropenem or meropenem with whatever, or piperacillin tazobactam at the very least. There'll be no doxycycline. That practice changed in CMC to say every undifferentiated fever will be empirically treated with doxycycline till we rule it in or rule it out. That changed things quite a bit. The second question you may ask me, you may say, so what if the mortality is 9% and critically ill 24%? There are several other diseases that we manage in the ICU with similar mortality or higher mortality. The answer is very simple, as I alluded to earlier. Simple treatment, rapid response to doxycycline. In fact, in those good old days, one of the diagnostic criteria was effervescence of fever within 2 days. It's highly suggestive of scrub typhus. When we were going through post-graduation course, one of our teachers used to teach us, if you are treating an enteric fever, whatever be the antibiotic, the appropriate antibiotic, the time to defervescence is 5 days. If the fever settles down before that, it's highly unlikely that it's enteric fever. On the other hand, if a patient comes with rapid onset fever, high grade fever, chills, rigors, pleuritic pain, dry cough, you're hearing bronchial breath sounds, you're diagnosing pneumococcal pneumonia, you initiate penicillin, fever crashes in 24 hours. So why I'm saying this is, it is so important to suspect, to treat appropriately, then your outcomes will improve. In fact, over time, as I said earlier, our outcomes with scrub typhus has been remarkably good, even for the very sick ones who come with multi-organ failure. Now, what are the choices of antibiotics that we have? This is a question that is often asked to us. IV doxycycline for a long time was not freely available. So we were reliant on oral doxycycline, and we were not sure whether the doxycycline is getting absorbed in our critically ill patients. In fact, last week when we analyzed some of our data on oral doxycycline administration or nasoenteral doxycycline in sicker patients with scrub typhus infection. And we found that in nearly half the patients, the drug levels were subtherapeutic. And that was the reason why clinicians moved on from giving just doxycycline as monotherapy to a combination of doxy plus azithro being given as an intravenous preparation. Now, these are the two drugs that are used standard. There is a large randomized control trial, multi-center trial that is happening in India, which is looking at a head-to-head comparison of doxy and azithromycin. And we hope that the results will be available in the next year or so. And CMC is also one of the partner institutions in that. There is some toxic resistance that is reported from other countries, but we have not really seen toxicycline resistance in India as yet. So I come back to the first question. Are we missing the diagnosis of scrub typhus infection? We probably have been, but now that you have attended this session, you are empowered. I would stop with this quote which says, what the eye doesn't see and the mind doesn't know doesn't exist. Now that you know that scrub typhus is a major problem in our country, there is no excuse if you miss the diagnosis. So I'll stop here and maybe take the questions. But I was fascinated by the first question that was asked, and if Anup feels it's good to start with that, I can start with that. Otherwise,
you can start with that, please, sir.
So the first question was, in the next 2-3 months, how common is scrub typhus? And what are some key pointers to differentiate severe scrub from COVID? Now, our experience with COVID is very limited. We have had only 3 patients in the ICU so far, of whom only 2 are ventilated. But we have been listening to webinars and talking to people and reading literature on how COVID lungs behave. But we do have a lot of experience with H1N1 infection. And when H1N1 infection and scrub typhus coexisted, we used to take a guess at the bedside based on the ventilation. Now, scrub typhus ARDS is very stiff lungs with a very poor compliance, and you struggle to ventilate them. High peak pressures, high plateau pressures, severely hypoxic. Here in H1N1, and I'm told it's the same for COVID, it's fairly compliant lungs, but they're so hypoxic. And maybe Anup can also add on to this, but you know, we used to really take a lot of pleasure in saying, okay, this is scrub, this is H1N1. And you'll send the test and will say, okay, yes, we were right. And I'm sure that scenario will happen even at this time. Yesterday, we were in a webinar talking to some of the overseas faculty, and they said, you know, they generate huge volumes, patients with COVID, particularly if they're on non-invasive ventilation, they said CPAP. And these huge volumes are not possible in scrub typhus. You will find the volumes of 150, 200, you're struggling. So you may be able to differentiate this clinically.
Sir, can I also add one point, sir?
Absolutely, please do.
And another thing, like what we observed is, usually the scrub, the moment they present to the hospital or ICU itself, they'll be sick and hypoxic. Only they'll be deteriorating and going for an hypoxic phase. So I think that also may be an additional point to differentiate clinically between COVID and scrub. What is your view on that, sir?
Agree with you. The other thing is, you would find that even in the sickest patient with ARDS, you will find within 48 hours, the ARDS starts improving so dramatically. That won't happen with COVID, in a majority of COVID patients. Nor did it happen with influenza. We used to struggle for days to weeks to get them off ventilator. Scrub behaves very differently.
People are asking about the clinical differentiation between dengue and scrub also, sir.
May not be very easy, but when you have a very leaky capillary syndrome, pleural effusions, hemoconcentration, high hematocrit. Again, as I said earlier, it's all rank order. You have a list of referentials. You examine carefully. See which epidemiological belt they're coming from. A large spleen, moderate spleen, it may point out more to malaria. Lots of pleural effusion, hematocrit that is high, may say, okay, this is probably dengue. And you know, about 30% of patients with dengue also have quite significant transaminitis. So I would say get back to basics, geographical area, good examination, rank order, send your relevant tests.
Like in short febrile illness, by definition, like when you say it's a short febrile illness, that is the next question by Dr. Krishna Kumar, sir.
Say 5 to 7 days, because most viral fevers would settle by 5 days. So less than 5 days, I would not really worry too much, unless they have a typical eschar, they have severe myalgia, and they're not settling down, then I would consider scrub.
So the next question by Dr. Kiran is on azithromycin, sir. Like especially when we have like extra infiltrates and all, the people may be starting to put down like a macrolide. So whether the previous exposure to the macrolide, may be the reason why the patients are having macrolide resistance, that's what he's asking. And to add on to
that, yeah. Tell me, sir.
Yeah, to add on to that, sir, like you were mentioning about, especially when the patient is on oral doxycycline, they were not attaining the therapeutic level what is required. And what is your experience when we are switching to IV doxycycline, same dose, sir, like whether they were attaining, or did you really study that IV versus oral?
We have not really formally studied it. Even in the sickest patients, there was response to doxycycline, but a little delay. And our experience was that one of the medical units was wanting to use only azithromycin. And our impression was they took a little longer to settle down.
But regarding the mortality wise, sir, other than the duration of stay or ICU, typically you are looking at whether it was making any difference, azithromycin versus doxy.
We will know once this RCT comes out, no? Okay. It's a very large RCT going on in difference.
And again, sir, one more doubt, like especially the clinicians are having that the doubt, especially like here, like when the serum transaminases are somewhere around 200 range, they're scared to start the patient on macrolide and doxycycline. So what is your advice for such a situation, sir?
I wouldn't hesitate to use, because this is related to the infection. But you monitor it 3 to 5 times the normal level. It's not a contraindication to use this combination or the macrolide.
And sir, one more question, sir, regarding this eschar. Like especially your papers, I've seen the incidence of eschar is quite high, somewhere around more than 40%. And some international papers is somewhere around less than 20%. So are we observing a more eschar incidence in India? Or what is the like present data on that eschar incidence in, especially scrub typhus? Don't take us a rickettsial fever, like common, only scrub.
We are looking for it. I think that's why we are picking it up. In fact, in certain patients, more than 50% you can pick up. Very careful. No, you will have to really, you know, they do a good job, because everybody has been trained to look for an eschar. So I would say at least 50% to 60% do have an eschar or a suspicion of an eschar.
And sir, can you just describe the fevers with other fevers with eschar, and again, any clinical differentiation of the nature of eschar, the distribution, or the way it produces scars, something like you can differentiate with other fever which can produce scars?
The only other one I told you is anthrax, which I've seen. I have not seen any other disease processes with eschar. But you have some experience, so maybe you should share what you have seen. Sometimes injury also we mistake, and then the family will say, no, he had an injury. And this, yeah,
that
this
is a major issue in the ICU. So they may say that the injection was taken at the site, or some cannula was put, so it is the heel scar only. And sir, other issue what we faced in Calicut was, like we used to get the patient presenting with something like a meningoencephalitis. Maybe having a slight hypoxic. But when we do a CSF, you will be having a slight lymphocytic predominant picture and a high protein, almost limiting, mimicking a TBM, but TBPCR will be negative. So how is your experience in such situations of scrub presenting as encephalitis?
We have seen a lot of patients presenting like that. In fact, in the early years, when we were not really looking for scrub typhus, many were mislabeled as TB meningitis and started on ATT plus steroids, but they were also covered with doxy. And you'll find within 2 or 3 days, they've woken up fully. And then you'll say, okay, must have been scrub, because TB will not respond so dramatically, say 48, 72 hours. The only other encephalopathy that I've seen sort of respond dramatically is malaria. Falciparum malaria I've seen, they respond sometimes very dramatically with therapy.
Okay. So suppose like we have a confusion at that point to differentiate between scrub and the TB. What is your take on repeating the CSF at the time of discharge and see how the CSF protein and the counts have settled?
So as I said earlier, if there is a very rapid and dramatic response, clinical
and... Can you just repeat, sir, like there was some disconnection.
So if there is a rapid clinical and CSF response to doxycycline, then I would put it down more in favor of scrub rather than TB or any other viral encephalitis. We shouldn't miss things like herpes. So we have to be very careful that we don't brand all that. That's what sometimes happens during the peak season of scrub typhus. Everything is branded as scrub typhus. And then people forget to think of other differentials, either tuberculosis or herpes. So the clinical syndrome is, that's why I keep going back to the clinical syndrome. The clinical syndrome of scrub will almost always have other organ dysfunction along with encephalitis. Occasionally, yes, they may present with predominantly an encephalitic syndrome, But that's the exception rather than the rule. Whereas TB and all, you'll have purely a neurological syndrome. You won't have the others unless it's a very advanced disseminated tuberculosis with liver involvement or liver, I mean, disseminated basically. You won't find this multi-organ dysfunction.
And sir, again, related to the encephalitis, meningoencephalitis only, I've seen like few people arguing for IV chloramphenicol over IV doxycycline as it is having a better CSF penetration. So what is your advice on that? And I've seen many clinicians using IV chloramphenicol, even if you start the patient on doxy, let's say that you have to go with IV chloramphenicol as it is having a better CSF penetration.
Excellent question. This was argued amongst clinicians in the early stages of our experience with scrub typhus. And the arguments were very similar to what you said. Excellent CSF penetration. It used to be the empiric choice of therapy for meningitis, both bacterial meningitis in the past. But the argument that people have given against that is with this probability of aplastic anemia, people are very, very concerned about using it. And the response to doxycycline has also been good. So we have not been using it at all. My recommendation is stick to doxy, it works.
Another issue, like we'll take the question afterwards, sir. Like another issue what we are facing, especially in Kerala, is like majority of the physicians, when they have a suspicion, they do a wheel Phillips. And when it is negative, they brand it as not scrub. So what is your advice to the audience on like excluding the scrub with using a wheel Phillips test? And again, the sensitivity and specificity or the so-called your predictive values on all in wheel Phillips. Here again, we got many questions also on the same topic.
It's actually a very poor sensitivity and specificity test. So if you're able to get the ELISA for scrub typhus done in a good lab, that will be ideal. And it's not too difficult to do. I've spoken to our microbiology department. They're saying it's quite easy to do. It's like any other ELISA test.
Now we have contest also, sir.
Yes. So if, on the other hand, your suspicion is not just scrub, but broader sense a rickettsial illness, like Rocky Mountain spotted fever, then you are better off probably sending a wheel Phillips also, not to the exclusion of scrub. Now, even if your IgM comes negative, the suspicion is very strong, you're still going to treat with doxy.
My second question is also the same related to that. Like suppose you have something like a like spotted fever or some other rickettsial fevers, your scrub type ELISA is negative. You are serially doing wheel Phillips. Serially, it is coming as negative. Maybe over the 1 week, you repeat it three times, the wheel Phillips is negative. Still, the fever, the patient is spiking on doxy also. So can you, do you think that is the point where we have to think about other causes and can we exclude at that point? 1 week of doxycycline not responding, serial wheel Phillips is becoming negative. So is it enough to exclude other, and again, your antibodies are also negative for scrub typhus. So is it at that?
I missed that last part alone.
No, like that, sir. Can we exclude the rickettsial fevers?
We have not seen too many of the other rickets here. But I remember one specific patient whom we were absolutely convinced it was rickets here. We did the entire panel of tests and they were all negative for others diseases and there was very poor response to doxycycline. So it is by exclusion we said it is rickettsial. The same problem we are facing with the COVID, we are now doing screening for the entire viral panel, adenovirus, rhino, corona of other types, influenza, parainfluenza. We are seeing a significant number of patients who are negative for everything, including bacteria, behaving like corona, but negative. And we have a kit which is picking up positivity in 1,000 dilution. So we are not sure Is there another pathogen that we are not picking up? I really don't know.
Related to that, Dr. Unnikrishna has asked one more question, sir. What is the chance of IgM scrub becoming false positive? Is there any other antibodies can cross react? Especially with the dengue, we have seen it can cross react with many other antibodies. I don't know about scrub, especially hepatitis and many other fevers. So here, have you ever come across something like that, sir? Dengue or some other fevers cross reacting with a scrub antibody, especially IgM.
I'm not too sure. Initially, you said IgG. It's very important that we test IgM. I'm not too sure. I need to check with the lab whether they cross-react. I think they do, but I don't want to offhand say something that I'm not too sure about.
And related to your previous comment on other coronaviruses, sir, 2 days before, we had Dr. Revi from NIMHANS as one of the speakers, and he was talking on herd immunity and immune response in COVID. So he was suggesting one of the reasons why the Kerala may not be having the severe disease, maybe the people might have come back with the coronavirus like MERS, or in Kerala people might have, or in India especially, people might have other coronaviruses infections, and that may be giving a cross immunity. So what is your comment on that, sir?
Very much possible. In fact, the first patient in whom corona was diagnosed was the common variety of corona in CMC. And unfortunately, somebody leaked it out to the press and we had a flag for it. And we had to spend about 24 hours trying to convince press and others. It's a totally different strain. It's a common cold strain. So you're right. We have never been looking for these viruses. But now we are looking for all these viruses. We are looking for adeno. We are looking for rhino. We have had adeno, rhinovirus positive. And in an epidemiological setting, adeno can also cause pneumonia. So you're absolutely right. We may be more immune. And that has been seen with H1N1. If you remember, the population that were born before 1955 did not really come down with very severe illness. And there was a cross-reactivity to that strain in the 1950s, which was postulated. So young people were dying with H1N1. So yes, it is very possible that we have some immunity as a nation.
Sir, other question is also related in the same direction. Is there any window period between the onset of symptoms and IgM response? Or putting it other way, if you look at IgM alone, is there a window period where you can miss the case? Something like in COVID, you look at IgM, in an early phase, you may miss it. You will have to look at specifically PCR. Same in dengue. Do we have any window period here in scrub also when you are making a diagnosis based on IgM?
I will tell you what my impression is. My impression is in the course of the disease, you will not pick it up. And most of our patients present a little late because they go roaming around the non-specific symptoms. They're treated as viral fever or something else. And so they generally present after a week. But in those where we have a very strong suspicion, if the first test comes negative, we do a repeat one in convalescent. There's another interesting phenomena that we observed in our patients. We actually looked at the entire cohort of patients with scrub typhus and looked at ANA expression in this group of patients. Now, the reason why we did this was scrub typhus is an infective vasculitis. In fact, for some of our very sick patients with scrub typhus, we've used a small dose of steroids and that has accelerated recovery. I don't have evidence for it, but we have used it. So when we looked at this ANA expression in critical illness, we found a lot of them, more than 50%, expressed ANA during the acute phase. We looked at it in the convalescent phase and the recovery phase, a majority of them became negative. So what I'm trying to say is there are lots of these immune responses that happen. And with our knowledge of antibody response to an antigenic stimuli, IgM will take at least 7 days. So to answer your question in a very indirect way, yes, in the early phase of illness, an IgM will not pick up. level of suspicion is high, repeat it.
Another question Dr. Vishal has asked is, peripheral distal vasculitis is very common with all these tropical fevers, or maybe the digital gangrene because of less perfusion, or maybe vasculitis. So, did you observe more such digital gangrene with scrub than with dengue, lepto, etc.? Because in Calicut, we have observed, sir, quite like it's very common. I've seen in many patients is having like severe digital gangrene, and even few patients they lost the fingers.
So I'll ask you a question. What is your vasoactive agent of choice in scrub typhus?
No, sir, you will have to repeat, sir. Sorry, some misconnection again.
What is your vasoactive agent of choice?
No, that
scrub typhus with shock.
No, we like all patients we start NORAD only. Sorry, those patients were not really hypotensive as well. Maybe only a minimal dose of NORAD only. They were hypotensive, I do admit.
So I was trained in a school of thought where we have used a lot of adrenaline in Australia.
Yeah.
And so I used a lot of adrenaline. Of course, my colleagues all use NORAD. Adrenaline gives a little bit of vasodilatation, peripheral vasodilatation. Now, you have a combination of infective vasculitis affecting your vessels. Patient is in shock. And on top of it, you squeeze with NORAD. It may increase the predilection for peripheral ischemia and gangrene. We have seen few, not many, with digital ischemia and gangrene needing, they've lost some digits, but it's not as common as you say it is. Maybe it's the choice of vasoactive agent. Maybe it's a touch of steroids in those sick patients where we minimize the inflammatory vasculitic phenomena. We don't know. I don't have evidence to tell you about it.
And like one person has asked about the pediatric scrubs, sir. How's the incidence and again presentation? Is it different, or like are you observing many pediatric patients in your like pediatric departments?
I won't be able to tell you the incidence, but they do see patients. I don't deal with pediatrics at all, but they do deal with patients.
Dr. Muthuraman has asked about GB wall edema in typhus fever. So I feel that is a very non-specific feature, because earlier days when we started using bedside ultrasound, we thought that this pericholecystic edema is very specific for dengue fever. But later on, it was observed in all the fevers. Like even now, I have a patient, like a girl returned from Delhi, initially suspected COVID. Then the fever was persisting. All other investigations were negative, developed mild thrombocytopenia. She had a mild cardiomegaly, later evaluated. The cultures were negative, even PCR negative, but the serial viral were positive and typhoid antibody was positive. So that patient was also having a significant pericholecystic edema or gallbladder edema. So my feel is it's not very specific.
I agree with you fully.
Sir?
Yes.
Yeah. Same only, no, sir?
I said I agree with you fully.
Okay, I agree. Sir. The people are asking about the leptospirosis diagnosis, because again, the poor sensitivity and specificity of the test, especially IgM antibodies. So, what is your institutional practice on leptospirosis diagnosis and again diagnostic test?
See, Anup, we don't see that much of leptospirosis. I think people in Kerala see a lot more, so you should be just answering that question. Very little in Velo.
Actually, sir, we started doing leptospirosis PCR very recently only. In last 2 weeks, I might have treated at least three patients. So all initial phases, the PCR was positive, but antibody response was appearing a bit late. So in that case, we usually repeat at the time of discharge, and by that time, all the patients were becoming positive. So I think it is sensitive, but again, we will have to look at serial values. That is my feel, sir. I didn't do a like a study on different groups, and I cannot say like that, but that is an observation what I made in few patients. And with the leptospirosis only, sir, like here in Kerala, like all the physicians are having a feeling that it is something like a criminal negligence if you are not treating such patients with the IV crystalline penicillin. So they still feel that even if the patient is on piperacillin tazobactam or ceftriaxone, the CP should be added, otherwise the patient will not get better. So what is your advice? Many persons in this topic, so I would like to hear from you. And again, it's not match fixing, don't think like that. I've not discussed with Peter sir this topic at all.
Simplest answer is piperacillin tazobactam also is the penicillin group, synthetic penicillin, pseudomonal penicillin. Even doxycycline has activity. So our ID people say anyhow these will cover your lepto. So we don't add CP here. Of course, our pretest probability is also low. So I think they may not be too concerned because patients anyhow are on doxycycline, which will cover, or if you're suspecting a superimposed bacterial sepsis, which happens in a proportion of patients with scrub, piperacillin tazobactam should take care of it. There is a question that somebody responded initially to doxycycline spiking fever again. Either your initial diagnosis is wrong, or there is a secondary bacterial infection. We find that about 5% of patients with severe scrub typhus, like in severe malaria, have a concomitant bacterial sepsis. So you have to be quite vigilant. Do a procalcitonin. If the procalcitonin is extremely high, we again looked at procalcitonin in severe scrub typhus. Patients are extremely sick. Procalcitonin goes up even in the absence of secondary bacterial sepsis. So you really have to look at whether you're missing something else.
The next question is again the loading dose. Whether we have to give a 200 milligram loading dose, then go like start with 100 milligram BD, or straight away start with 100 milligram BD. And again in IV, also the same, or loading dose required?
I would recommend to give a loading dose till we have more information. There are other disease processes where they've shown a loading dose helps. So there's no harm in giving a loading dose. You get to your therapeutic levels faster.
Dr. Sandhya is asking, sir, like, do you routinely use, routinely do CSF study in a patient with fever and altered sensorium, or do you need any specific findings, or will you wait for some more time? Like, especially in a setting of like acute undifferentiated.
Very good question.
Fever with sensorium.
Excellent question. If the syndromic picture fits in with a typical scrub, you don't do a routine CSF. You don't gain anything by it. You have a patient with an eschar, breathlessness, transaminitis, altered sensorium. You know it's a meningoencephalitis related to scrub typhus, you don't need to do. Or a malaria with an encephalopathy, do you need to do a CSF? But if you are thinking of an alternative diagnosis, if you're thinking that maybe raised ICP, do a CT, make sure I'm not missing something and do a CSF. That will be my general algorithm. Routine CSF is not required.
Other question is, like for me, it's a bit difficult. For you, I think it will be easy. Like how to differentiate between Kawasaki and typhus? Share your experience.
It's a long time since I've seen a Kawasaki. Yeah. So, very long time.
Adult, do you see Kawasaki? No, sir. It's almost nil, no?
Very, very rare. Typically, it's described in children. In the adult population, I have not really seen. It comes in our list of differentials, but it's generally ruled out because of the age and the presentation and other alternative diagnoses.
Sir, Dr. Oma is asking, like, what number of patients or what percentage of patients do you have who are not responding to doxycycline with scrub?
It's a difficult question. More recently, we have seen a slight delay in response. But I've not really seen a non-response to doxy if your pretest probability of scrub is so high. Instead of defervescence in 2 days, we have seen defervescence in 4 to 5 days. If in doubt, we always add an azithromycin with that. We have not really used rifampicin for poor response, although it is recommended. We have not used it.
So, like with continuation with that, sir, if you're like adding rifampicin, will you stop doxy and add rifampicin or continue rifampicin along with doxy?
Not sure. I would say I wouldn't stop doxy because it's such a standard drug, it's a cheap drug, it's well tolerated. I really wouldn't stop doxy.
And what will be the dose of rifampicin, sir? The same TB dose or you want a more dose?
I've given it in the presentation. I can't tell you offhand, but I'll quickly look at the presentation. 600 to 900 milligrams daily for 7 days. It's a fairly high dose.
Dr. Om Prakash is asking, what is the sensitivity and specificity of pyridol test when you are doing it for an undifferentiated fever?
From memory, it's only about 40 to 50%. Right. I'm not
less than 40%. Sure. Right. But serial pyridol, sometimes giving a better clue, I feel, sir. And again, a few patients I was looking, the pyridol positivity in the Calicut area, we compared in 3 institutions almost 5 years back. It was all other data, it was very, very less. Only the serial pyridol value, sir.
We are not seeing that much of Ventric now. But many years back, we were taught if it's within a week, do blood cultures, you will pick it up, most likely. Or bone marrow cultures. We used to do routinely bone marrow cultures. And when blood cultures are negative, bone marrow used to pick it up. Your problem comes when you're in the second week of illness. That's where the challenge comes. Again, as I said during the presentation, we were taught that if you think it's enteric, you have empirically started therapy for enteric, you'll have to wait 5 to 6 days for defervescence. 5 days. And I clearly remember a patient who presented like an enteric, but 5th day fever didn't come down. And my professor said, no, this cannot be enteric. Let's send off a vasculitic workup. Young lady, acute presentation. Within 48 hours, she developed massive arterial and venous thrombosis and died within the next few days. So we do see unusual presentations, but the typical teaching is enteric time defervescence in 5 days.
The next question is also related to that, sir, by Dr. Prashant. He's asking, suppose if you have a PEO, that is after 2 weeks. So by that time, if the patient is not having a specific organ failure, do you have to really suspect rickettsial fevers, especially scrub typhus in that group?
I would still keep it in the list of my differentials, but on a lower probability, because by the 2nd week, generally they develop some organ dysfunction. I don't remember offhand, but vaguely I remember that it's the natural history is about 4 weeks. They either die by then or recover. From the Japan, the wartime data, but I'm not absolutely certain. I need to go back and look.
IV minocycline, any role, sir? One for Dr. Ganesh is asking.
I have no idea.
Severe features like ARDS or brain features, encephalitis.
I'm not sure. People have thought of digicycline, IV digicycline. In fact, in our earlier discussions on what should be the randomized controlled trial, digicycline was also considered. But then we decided not to go down that path because it's a high-end antibiotic that is used in other settings.
Next question is also related to the same thing, sir. If on doxycycline, if the patient spikes the fever again, so They have not told about secondary infection. I'll add that also after excluding secondary other bacterial infection. Sir is having some problem with the connection, I think.
So it again boils down to how confident. Can you hear me now?
Can you let me?
Is it better?
The disconnection, yeah.
Yeah, it's a little unstable here at the moment. Is it better?
Yeah, now fine, sir. Now you can continue.
I go back to this. You can access it. There's still a small probability this could. Resistance, drug resistance to drugs. I don't think there is a way to, you know, diagnose doxy resistance at the moment.
Okay. Sir, with that, can we move on to case discussion, sir? Can you stay back for some more time with us? Or are you busy?
I can stay for another 10 minutes.
If you're busy, you can leave. No problem. We'll just take for a one case discussion, then we'll stop it.
Sure. Maybe I'll then take leave. Thank you all. It was a very enlightening discussion. Thank you, Anup, for having me here. Take care.
So, friends, we have one more case-based discussion, but I need someone to volunteer for that discussion. So, please raise your hand so that we can have a discussion. Without anyone raising the hand, I cannot. Take it for a discussion. So, like anyone is interested for, yeah, two persons are there. So, we have anyone else? Someone else was actually volunteering me for the discussion. Okay. We have three persons here. Can you introduce yourself? Dr. Uma Devi.
Yes, sir.
Can you please introduce yourself?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah. So I'm Dr. Uma Devi. I'm working as a consultant physician at General Hospital, Irinyalakuda, Thrissur district.
Physician. Dr. Arjun.
So I'm Dr. Arjun. I'm working as an emergency physician at my own hospital, and I have an ICU setting. I have done FMB critical care.
So where are you working, sir?
So I'm working in my own hospital, sir. KLS Hospital and KLS ICU and emergency.
Place.
Hospital, sir. Bellary, Karnataka.
Okay. Bellary. Okay, fine. Sir, Hukum, sir. Hukum Chand Sharma.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir. I am Hukum Chand Sharma. I am doing DNB critical care medicine in Safdarjung Hospital, Delhi.
Okay. So this is a case scenario. Okay. So I'll just. Fever, dry cough, and vomiting. It was about 2 weeks duration. Initially, she was treated in Hyderabad. Am I audible? Any issues?
Audible, sir.
Okay. So she was initially treated in Hyderabad. So after a few days, this was happening a few months back. So she has landed here in my hospital with eschar-like skin lesions. She was irritable. She had severe headache. And she is giving a history of contact with cats as well. So her BP was 90-60, was tachycardic, and other systemic examination was within normal limit. So this was her initial blood investigations, hemoglobin 11.2, total count of 4,100 with the neutrophil 86%, lymphocyte 13, platelet count was 1,47,000, ESR was 15, creatinine normal, bilirubin normal, liver enzymes normal, and urine routine within normal limit. Okay, so she was having lesions like this. Okay. So, Dr. Uma, your comments?
So, both these lesions are the same or it's on different sides?
No, one is in the, like, almost in the skin, other is in the thigh.
Usually, eschars are seen on the hidden areas. For the shin.
No, this is not a spotter. Like, you have to tell me like how we are going to approach this person. The diagnosis will take time. That we can discuss later.
Yes, sir.
What else you want to know about this patient?
Any travel?
Travel part, I'll tell you 1 minute. Now, that actually I did in the last, I'll tell you the travel part. So this is a travel history. Like in the, I told you, you know, she was coming to our hospital on August 10th. So in the history from August 9th to 12th, she is giving a history of a visit to Agra. So I specifically asked if there is any visit to lake caves, forest, or eating any raw meat or any other like involved in any water sports, or like she attended in any party, etc. So it was completely negative. She's not giving any such history. Then she's not having any addictions. Only thing, she has some pet cats in her home. Then after that, she came back 13th, 20. She is not, there is nothing significant. There is no contact history with any similar febrile illness in Hyderabad. Then from 21 to 28, she had fever, rigor, vomiting. She was treated there, but no details available at that point. So this is her travel history. And again, the 1 month history which I got. Anything else you want to know?
Occupation?
She's a media person. She's working for some media in Hyderabad. So here, initially she was admitted in neuro ICU. So obviously the differential diagnosis at this point.
Undifferentiated fever to.
Yeah. And you will be having only one diagnosis.
And then
you have scrub typhus and again.
Toxoplasmosis,
why?
Contact.
She had history of contact with cats. So obviously what treatment you want to start at this point? What treatment? What drug will you start? Arjun, Sukum.
Sir, I can start with the doxycycline.
Only doxycycline. Mm-hmm. But here again, the patient is not having any organ involvement. Patient is not having any lung involvement. Liver enzymes are absolutely normal.
Sir, you can start with doxycycline.
Yeah, doxycycline started, but I think again we can start the patient on ceftriaxone also. Steroid anyway is not indicated at that point of time. So as usual, the patient was CSF examination was done. So this is a CSF finding. The protein is absolutely normal. The count is also fine. This is absolutely fine. And even though the CSF is fine with the skin lesions, the patient was started on chloramphenicol. The staph in the skin lesions was shown staph infection, and she was started on clindamycin as well. Okay, So a patient is continued to be febrile, but her sensorium improved. So the blood culture was sterile, but skin lesions grew till the bone. Scrub antibody was negative. Weill Felix is also negative. The skin biopsy was done because it was not conclusive. She developed rashes all over the body and again temperature spikes. So this was on day one in the hospital. She improved and she was shifted to the room with the same treatment what we have mentioned. She was almost doing fine. And later on, as the fever was continuing, the patient was rediscussed. Chloramphenicol clindamycin was stopped because here you can see when it was reevaluated, her liver enzymes were going too high. Okay, so what is your inference here? USP normal. On reevaluation, with the fever persisting, this is the finding. No, just this is for a discussion sake, an imaginary case. Don't think about the diagnosis too much. We just wanted to know how you are going to approach the patient. That's all.
So because the fever is lasting for more than 2 weeks and there is a cutaneous skin lesion of black eschar, and hence with goes in favor of scrub typhus.
He was on doxycycline initially, received for almost 5 days, more than a week. Patient not responded, even was given chloramphenicol. But this is the lab findings now. What is your inference on lab findings?
She has developed pancreatitis, worsening of liver function, and mild renal derangement also.
So that's okay. That I've shown. What is the inference?
Now it's involving two and
Multi-organ
three
dysfunction.
organs. Multi-organ dysfunction is there.
Multi-organ dysfunction.
That's the reason how you are going to approach. Still with the same diagnosis and want to stop doxy and continue chloramphenicol, or want to do something else? Want to do some other test? Do you have anything else in mind?
Viral
Especially, I'll give you
test.
one. I will give you one. Sorry, viral test.
Viral test.
Viral was negative.
Repeat the scrub typhus.
Scrub typhus and Weill Felix were also repeated at that time. It was also negative.
Dengue, sir. Dengue.
Dengue initially itself, she presented after a week here. The antibody initially itself was negative.
No, she's dead.
So, do you suspect anything else? A patient continued to have fever on second week, and the end of second week, the patient is having a liver enzyme elevation. Do you suspect anything else?
Leptospirosis.
Infective endocarditis.
With this much. Infective endocarditis is a very good ability. Creatinine is elevated, the liver enzymes are elevated. Okay, post. Absolutely normal. So with this thing, the antibiotics, everything was lost. The protective drugs. Patient still had temperature spikes. The lepto, and blood culture negative. Again, other things. So the possibility, obviously, what you have to think is obviously a doxy induced or treatment, its details may not be knowing. And again, we are repeating the liver function after a week. So maybe at the time of presentation, she may not have developed a liver dysfunction. So at this point, she may be developing a liver dysfunction or some autoimmune possibilities. The possibility considered at that point of time. About, after a week and after developing liver dysfunction, she was with liver chills, she was saturating, and immediately RRT was on. Patient She's patent, she's able to cough, she's hypoxic on 5 liters, and again 40 per saturation, BP is low, and she's full time condition, echo is looking fine, and again bilateral B profile, this patient not A, conscious oriented, and again there is no organomegaly, no ascites, no hepatosplenomegaly. So we have stabilized NIV, did the probable, so what will you suspect at this point? Why, what is the reason, and again how to proceed? Patient is in the ICU now. Dr. Arjun, Hukum, Dr. Uma, you can give the suggestions. This is a patient in your hospital. You don't think about the diagnosis.
So bacterial sepsis.
Yeah, obviously, yeah. It is a new onset sepsis. You should definitely the patient has had like skin lesions and doing a blood culture is fine. Other possibilities? So obviously, you have to reevaluate such patients, right?
Yes.
So this is like PEO, and again, you will have to reevaluate the patient. Sorry, I'll just 1 minute. So this is our different investigations, serial investigations.
So the screen is not seen.
Sorry?
So the screen is not seen.
Not screen, huh? So, okay, sorry. I will... Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Anything else in your mind? What are the abnormalities? Well, just interpret the reports.
Thrombocytopenia.
So he's having a worsening thrombocytopenia.
Left deranged.
Yeah, liver is deranged, but what is the trend? This is on for day 15 and this is on day 17 of fever.
Continuously, there's thrombocytopenia.
Yeah. Liver at times are actually improving. Renal parameters are also improving now. She's having coagulopathy, but it's. Not worsening in last 3 days. All other tropical fever, PCR negative, Weill Felix negative, scrub typhus negative, ANA negative, or other viral markers like being hepatitis. That is the one you have to always specifically look at. That is the one I wanted to tell you at that point. Whenever you have a like liver enzyme elevation of this range, you have to always look at viral hepatitis markers. So that was done. Peripheral smear always you have to look at, because maybe like malaria or something. So that was normal. Skin biopsy is also inconclusive.
We can go for procalcitonin levels.
Procalcitonin was negative, 0.4 or something. And while looking at her previous, the pictures, which she collected, the parents collected later. So she had lesions in her, this is her face initially, then over the neck, then over the shin. So forget about diagnosis, like what are the other things you are going to suspect a patient developing like a liver dysfunction, especially a prolonged fever at the end of second week, and again continue to have fever spikes. Let me look at the chats. Friends are typing. Sorry. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Vasculitis, somebody is suspecting.
Can be drug induced.
Yeah, drug induced, but they are not given anything, no? Anka yeah. And complement levels. Complements in her level were negative. Anka was sent, Anka was also negative, but she was not having any lung lesions or even though the hypoxemia was there, I forgot to tell you that it was basically because of fever spike, and later on, after the fever settled, she has improved late. Hematological malignancy, peripheral smear, everything is normal. Yeah, one person has asked me to do ferritin LDH bone marrow to see hemophagocytosis, HLS, mass. Yeah, so many people have commented that nicely. So that is the point I wanted to tell at this point. Even if in I will come to the diagnosis later, we have a separate session on prolonged fever evaluation. But that is the point I wanted to convey with this session, especially a prolonged fever, even if it is because of a scrub typhus. If the patient is developing a continuous fever spikes with something like an interleukin surge, or like say that SIRS response, you have to always look for macrophage activation like syndrome or HLH. So how will you diagnose HLH in this patient? Looking at only ferritin values or marrow or something else? Dr. Hukum, Dr. Arjun, Dr. Uma? Hemophagocytosis, how will you diagnose? Okay, we will have a separate session on hemophagocytosis, but that's an important finding in an ICU setting, especially when you evaluate fever, whether it is a dengue fever or scrub typhus, and especially in our Calicut-Wayanad area, Caesarnour forest disease. Whenever we have this monkey fever or Caesarnour forest disease, the incidence of hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, HLH, or nowadays we call it as MALS, macrophage activation like syndrome, is very high. And we usually evaluate that with something called an echo. You can delay it if you are going with that history. So now again, we will go to the second patient. I'm not going to the diagnosis and further evaluation because of the shortage of time. We will have a session on prolonged fever and approach in a different way. So this is a 54-year-old lady, diabetic on oral anti-hyperglycemic agents. And again, she's on her HbA1c, glycosylated hemoglobin is 8. She's presenting with a fever history of 5 days, cough for 4 days, breathing difficulty 2 days. She was treated in local hospital for 1 day. Hypoxicon presentation and tachypneic. So she shifted to the ICU on NIV. Plus, she's on 10 liters of oxygen. And on evaluation, like airway patent, she's able to cough, saturating on 90 now in ICU with 5 liters of oxygen on NIV. Respiratory rate is 40 per minute. BP is like borderline tachycardic. She's irritable, no skin lesions. And examination-wise, normal LV function, no pericardial effusion on a screening echo. Clinical examination, cardiovascular system normal. She is having a bilateral B profile. Other than that, chest examination and ultrasound examination is normal. There is no signs of meningeal irritation, no focal neurological deficit. She is also irritable. She is having a mild splenomegaly, no ascites, no hepatomegaly. And this is her chest X-ray. She is having bilateral infiltrates in chest X-ray. So what is your approach to this patient? And this is our investigations. Hemoglobin is 10.4, total count 6.4, slightly neutrophil predominant, thrombocytopenia, creatinine of 1.6, BUN 64, ATP320, amylase is slightly elevated, bilirubin is 3.4, OTPT is slightly elevated, alkaline is normal, and LDH is also minimally elevated only. Okay, fine. Can I stop sharing?
Yeah.
Blood sugar is now it's normal.
So with a short fever history and cough and breathlessness.
Okay.
And we should first suspect for leptospirosis, as it is involving multi-organ, which is involving her lungs with mild crackles, and also there is transaminitis with liver being involved, and thrombocytopenia, and creatinine being little on the higher side. So multi-organ dysfunction with lung involvement and short fever history would think of leptospirosis.
Okay, I have reasonably good thinking, but what are the points against leptospirosis here, Dr. Uma?
She's an elderly lady. She's an elderly lady, diabetic.
Sorry, I'm asking about what are the points against leptospirosis in this patient, if you are arguing against leptospirosis.
Travel history and contact history.
Patient is from Calicut, my area. This is an, like leptospirosis endemic area. So you don't need any travel history here. So usually, this is a high possibility. But one point is against is usually you will not get such an early ARDS like picture in leptospirosis. You will get only in one situation. Can you tell what is the situation where you will get a early ARDS? Can anybody chat in that? Or anyone else in this group?
Mm-hmm.
No, not pancreatitis. She's not having any pancreatitis. There is a pulmonary variant of leptospirosis. We used to get
wilt disease.
And somebody has commented pulmonary hemorrhage. Pulmonary hemorrhage is very quite common in leptospirosis. But the issue is the chest X-ray picture is not suggestive of a pulmonary hemorrhage. Majority of the time, you may be having bilateral diffuse infiltrates. Yes, possible with this picture as well, but the CT picture will be entirely different. So it's very common here with pulmonary hemorrhage. And another point against leptospirosis will be you may not expect such a huge elevation of SGOT, SGPT on a day 5 with leptospirosis. Usually a borderline elevation with a more on alkaline phosphate elevation is what we usually observe. And urine will be having a microscopic hematuria. That is again possible. Okay. For other possibilities, what about dengue? Dengue possible?
Dengue can be.
Obviously, we have to rule out dengue also, but again, the ARDS is also possible, liver enzymes possible, renal parameters, derangement possible. But obviously, by this time, you will be able to pick up the case, like especially in initial day 4 or initial days, you are doing an NS1 or a PCR test, it's easy to pick up. But day 5 or something, you may miss with the PCR and dengue NS1. But dengue is also possible. Usually, you will be having a high hemoglobin concentration in a patient with dengue. So hemoglobin concentration you are not seeing here. Then what are the other possibilities you can consider? Will you do an influenza SAP? Influenza?
Yes, sir. H1N1 would be also be a possibility.
Yeah, again, the organ dysfunction with H1N1 is again, especially going with a high, very, very high liver enzymes, and again, early renal failure, that also with a normal CPK. It's usually unusual with a, it's not usually seen with influenza. Okay. So, what are the other possibilities? Acute undifferentiated
consolidation.
No, there is no obvious. The cultures are sterile. Malaria causing ARDS is a possibility, but our malaria card test and you have to do the malaria card test and definitely you will have to do the peripheral smear as well. Viral markers are negative. Viral markers, obviously, we have to do a viral markers. Honda virus, maybe we can consider, but again, this much liver enzyme elevation, everything difficult. We'll think about common infections in this patient. Sarcoidosis, this is on day 5. Thinking about fungal pneumonia, sarcoidosis, HRCT, possible, but very rare. As Dr. Peters was mentioning, You will have to put the investigations in order and then we'll have to decide. What is the other possibility, especially when early presentation of ARDS and a multi-organ failure? What other thing will you suspect? What are the other common differential diagnosis?
And tropical fever.
Yeah, that can be a tropical fever. That is a huge entity, no? And what treatment will you start for this patient? Now, friends, this is a situation where you should definitely think about a scrub typhus. That is why I selected a scenario like that. Even if you are not getting a skin lesions, you should think about scrub typhus in this situation, like early and onset of ARDS, the multi-organ dysfunction. That obviously, usually the scrub typhus, the count is towards the higher side. This is not seen here. But early ARDS and hypoxemia in a patient, you have to always think about scrub, especially if you're working in an area where scrub is very common. Even if you're not having an eschar, you should definitely suspect and start the patient on doxycycline. Okay, I just wanted to convey that message with this case scenario. Okay, so this was a nice discussion. And again, we will have other fever scenarios soon. Especially on approaching of a PEO, and again different tropical fevers. Like today we have covered scrub typhus. We will be having other close differential diagnosis of COVID, like leptospirosis, dengue fever, enteric fever, all those things also in the coming sessions we will cover. And tomorrow we will be having a session on ICU rounds, especially in an ICU, what are the things we have to look at. And we will be having Dr. Subba Reddy from Apollo Hospitals, Hyderabad. He'll be talking. He will be talking on ICU daily rounds and how to set a ICU daily round and what are the points to be looked at that point. Okay. Anything else? Anybody want to add? Anyone want to add something or about any other points? Chat, should you consider melioidosis? Melioidosis, Jagannath, yeah, melioidosis also depending on the area, but on a diabetic patient, especially coming with a pneumonia, multi-organ failure, melioidosis is also a possibility, but usually I've not seen the patient with a developing all the organ failures, developing transaminitis, renal failure, hypertension and ARDS. It's possible. I'm not saying that it's not possible, but again, your priority will be on the lower side. Anything else? Dr. Kumar or Dr. Uma, you want to add?
Yes, sir. Initially, just sharing an experience. Initially during a PG session, any patient coming with fever, we were always suspecting leptospirosis, and the patient was started on CP like that. And any patient not responding to CP crystalline penicillin, then we used to start that patient on doxycycline. And later on, when few patients started seeing that there's an eschar present, then that was an essential part in the examination, that we should definitely look for the eschar in each patient. We have to see each and every hidden area and find out if there is an eschar, because only if we look for that particular skin lesion, we'll be seeing that. So yeah. By the end of the first year, it was a compulsory that for any patient presenting with fever, we have to look and definitely say that whether eschar was present or not.
Yeah. It's a very good, Oma. That is the one we should learn from today's presentation. And again, as a PG student, I also heard from Dr. Peter talking from that time onwards on especially on rickettsial fevers and eschar, and the Vellore, they have extensively worked on these rickettsial infections. So that is how we also started knowing that many of the leptospirosis we are diagnosing in Kerala were these rickettsial infections. That is why all the case scenarios what I've shown you now, the two scenarios, what you have to do is you have to start empirically on ceftriaxone and doxycycline in all such patients. That is the usual approach we follow in India. That is why I asked Peter sir also the same question. You don't have to specifically go with CP. If you start with ceftriaxone, the doxy advantages, like you can cover scrub typhus, you can cover enteric fever, and again other common infections as well. So if you start on ceftriaxone doxycycline, you will be having a wide coverage of these tropical infections. And again, at the same time, you can look at other investigations and again other causes as well. But if your diagnosis is not clear, you should definitely start the patient on doxycycline, especially if you are working in South India. I don't know about the incidence in North India. Okay, yeah. So I think Dr. Sanish, are you there?
Fine.
Yeah. Anything else you want to add? So today, like, we have created a WhatsApp group. It was an excellent response. Like, even with the four WhatsApp group, it was getting filled very fast. So I expected somewhere around 500 plus participants today. But today we had average 250 participants only. But that is good. We have a reasonably good crowd. So next week also we will be having Monday, Tuesday on mechanical ventilation. Again, Dr. Chandrasekhar will be joining us. Wednesday, we'll be having some interesting sessions like what we had this week. We are contacting many speakers. Some interesting topic cover, everybody can enjoy. Then Thursday, Friday, Saturday, we are considering different options. Like, one is on enteral nutrition, giving you an insight. And again, some highlights on tropical fevers, like a dengue fever or leptospirosis in detail. And other thing what we are planning is a tutorial on antibiotics, like how to select antibiotics and different antibiotics, all those things. So if you have any other suggestions for next week, please put it in the chat box. And we are extremely sorry that we were not able to upload the previous NIV videos and mechanical ventilation videos. So that time our YouTube streaming was not working properly. So I was recording it in my system, and there were some issues in recording, because as we were doing for the first time, we were also not very good in technologically in doing all those things. So that is why some problems happened, but those recordings are there in my system, huge files. So probably we'll upload all those good sessions what we had in the initial days. Repeating the session on NIV, yes, at a later time, definitely we'll consider that. The previous sessions in YouTube, now you cannot access all the sessions. From mechanical ventilation to everything is available. Fungal infections, definitely we'll consider. Talked to some ID specialist also, they will be joining us on fungal infection. But being an advanced topic, after covering all the common topics only, we'll go to fungal infection. Not now, maybe after 2 months or so. Okay. So thank you so much, and good night. Good night, Sanish sir. Want to add something?
No, nothing. Thanks.
We will be having sessions on oxygen therapy, other common ICU equipments, all those things soon. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.